Welcome into 0-60. Happy Monday. I'm your host, Matt McChesney. Bree Masis is behind the computer back here on the ones and twos, producing this monstrosity as we roll here on 0-60 on the Bleav Network. We've got a good guest for you here this morning, and we will get to him in a second here. But as always, our show is brought to you by our good friends at Bet Online. The tournament is here. Obviously, the opening weekend was pretty fantastic. Bet Online is your bracket headquarters for all your bets this season. All the contests, the odds, the lines, they are elite, and you can get your best odds and wagering information there, leading all the way up to the national championship. You can access the most up-to-date wagering information minute by minute as you go through. You can live bet during the games. Head to Bet Online today and get in on the action. Remember, use the promo code Bleav for 50% off on your welcome deposit and your first bonus. Bet Online is where the game starts, and they're our title sponsor, and we are very thankful to them and all that they do. Today on the show on 0-60, my good friend Mario Vetanze is going to come. How do you say his fucking last name?
Vetanze
is going to be coming on the show to talk shop and talk about all that he does and this incredible video he put up honoring Russell Wilson this weekend on top of many other things. So let's get into it here. Remember, you can go find us on Twitch now. It's streaming on Twitch this morning at 60 Academy on Twitch, and then all over social media on TikTok, on Twitter, on Instagram, and TikTok's awesome. So make sure we keep posting on that fucked up app. All right, so let's get this started. My man Mario's coming into the show. Mario, what's up? How you doing this morning? Good morning.
What's up, Mr. McCheesy? It's really great to be here. Thanks so much for having me.
Yeah, I'm glad you came on the show. I know that you're a big CU fan. Obviously, Breeze is a big CU fan. We'll talk about the tournament first. Is that the best Colorado basketball team you've ever seen? And was that the best fucking game against Florida college basketball-wise? It's the best game I've ever seen. Where do you stand on all that?
Yeah, I mean, statistically, I mean, it was the most wins they ever had. You would have loved to see them go into the Sweet 16, and had it not been for a really bad first half against Marquette, you know, I'm still convinced that they're the better team. Marquette was shooting lights out. CU was not playing the game that they had kind of played all year. And they turned it on the second half. Unfortunately, it was too little too late. But yeah, man, that Florida game was an absolute classic. I think that was kind of peak CU basketball right there. And even though it ended prematurely, it was still a ton of fun to see that run. It was fun to see Tad Boyle continue to have the success that he's had and once again make the tournament. Probably should have been seeded a little bit higher. Having to play that play-in game, I thought was BS. And if you want to talk about that at some point where the 10 seeds have to do a play-in game, like that, like 16 seeds.
Why is that? Why do they do that shit?
That makes no sense to me. I would love for someone who's smarter than me to try and explain it. I don't know. That's what I'm saying. Like they didn't deserve to be in the play-in game. Honestly, you could make the argument that Colorado State didn't deserve to be in the play-in game either, but there they were. And I don't know how much it affected them. You know, you never want to look for excuses. Maybe they're fresher against the Marquette. I don't know, but it was stupid. And any explanation that I'm going to get as to why 10 seeds are having to do play-in games and 11 through 15 aren't, I'm not trying to hear it because it's stupid.
Well, it seems to me like they're trying to like make a molehill out of a mountain here, or a mountain over a molehill, that you've got 10 seeds with 24 wins that have to play each other, and then you've got a 19 win Michigan State that looks like they get on a name recognition. They won a game, of course, but still, like, they had 19 wins and they're a 9 seed. Like, it doesn't make sense to me. And do you think that extra game helps CU or hurts CU?
I mean, I guess it remains to be seen. I would have loved to see the alternate universe where they didn't have this play-in game and see if that changed the game against Marquette at all. Again, you don't want to make excuses. Obviously, you know that better than anybody. But that notwithstanding, like, it was stupid. And they didn't play a great game against Boise State. They still got the win. And so maybe it's just one of these things where it was nice to kind of shake the rust off, I guess, even though they had a really good tournament run in the Pac-12. But I think you could make a case either way. I just would have loved to see if they didn't have to, you know, succumb to that play-in game, and maybe we're a little bit more fresh against a really talented team in Marquette. So I'm going to say that, yeah, if it wasn't for the playing game, they definitely would have beat Marquette. Why not?
Why not? I agree. Well, now look, I think that there's a lot of people in this, you know, in the basketball community out here. I keep seeing fire Tad, get rid of Tad. I mean, they lost to Oregon in the Pac-12 title game, bro. And I don't know how many fucking tweets I saw from just idiots out here saying, we should fire Tad Boyle. I mean, what? They just had the most wins in program history. They've got pros all over the court. How is it that people can't remember how bad Colorado basketball was for so long?
It drives me crazy, man. And Tad Boyle actually took over when I was in school there, and he's been fantastic. I mean, Colorado is anything but a powerhouse in basketball. Yeah, they're not a powerhouse in basketball. It's like making the tournament for a team like CU, that's a big deal. The fact that they were able to do it and, you know, go on a little bit of a mini run and really give Marquette everything that they had to offer when Marquette, I believe, was like 5.5-point favorites and is, you know, pretty well determined as the better team. Like anybody wanting to fire Tad Boyle, it's this knee-jerk reaction where if a team isn't playing up to people's gaudy standards, they always want to fire the coach first. That's always going to be the first thing that they say. And maybe it was because they had as much talent as they did. Like, this is easily the most talented CU roster that we have ever seen. And so I guess maybe the expectations were a little bit higher. I don't know if the Deion Sanders effect has anything to do with it, where, you know, you're expecting greatness and your expectations are a little bit too high. But I mean, this is really the best that you can hope for. And I think as a CU fan, you're hoping that they get hot at the right time and maybe go on a little bit of a run. But again, being there and Tad having the success this season that he had, firing him just makes absolutely no sense, because then the question that you have to answer that no one can seem to answer anytime you want to fire the head coach, you then have to find a new coach. Who are you going to find that is going to have the success, the sustained success that Tad Boyle has had for an admittedly non-basketball school? It's just, again, it's stupid. Anybody wanting to fire Tad Boyle just doesn't know the game and they're not familiar with CU basketball.
All right, so look, I think that they should extend him and give him a fucking raise, and we should keep the party going. So, you know, to be completely honest with you, I think that they've got a ton of potential moving forward. I mean, this team is going to be absolutely loaded moving forward into next season and ranked high. So, look, tip of the cap to Colorado this year, tip of the cap to CSU. Both teams getting into the tourney, that was pretty cool. Both teams winning the game, pretty cool. So there's a lot of talent out here on the front range in Fort Collins and Boulder, both those basketball buildings. So we'll keep that going. Now all eyes on the Nuggets and the Avs to see if they can get a cup and an NBA Finals championship at the same time. Brother, that would be fucking dope. The last 2 years there's been back-to-back parades, so hopefully they can do one at the same time. A little combo parade, that would be pretty cool. But look, that's neither here nor there. Here nor there. We'll talk about all that as we get going. But look, you put out a video. Tell everybody your social media handle so they know where to go find this.
Yeah, you can find it at Vetanze Therapy. I'm sure everybody has seen Matt.
Just grab the football.
Russell Wilson of course I do. This thing goes everywhere with me. It's a Duke, so we got to break it in. We got to, like, you always got to have it on hand. See, when you put out these really fantastic good workout videos that I put out, right? When you put it out, you have to take it seriously.
Fucking, you need to come train the quarterback. You need to come train the quarterbacks at 6-0. You need to come train the quarterbacks at 6-0 ready, dude, based on this fucking video. Now, everyone, watch this.
You know what? You say the word and I'll be there.
Yeah, watch Mario in this video, and then, wow, this is...
Say you touch me, how sweet.
love the work.
There it is. Love the work. Is it
weird that you look better than him?
You know, it's funny. I will say this. For the most part, I think everybody understood that it was a parody. Everybody understood that it was just supposed to be, you know, a joke. And I got a couple of people. Real. I didn't want to steal your shine here. Okay.
No, there we go. That's how we roll.
We'll dial back in. You know, there's a handful of people, of course, that are going to be really upset about it. And people are like, oh, you took all that time out of your day. You know, you wasted all your time. Like, I had a blast doing that. And we played a pickup football game afterwards. It's like, I will do that any day of the week. And I said on Twitter that I was going to do it. And I do what I'm going to say. What I say I'm going to do, I do. And so, of course, there's people who were upset by it. And I'm like, there was nothing special about what he did. And I just wanted to underline that because as Bronco fans, we were tricked into the same sorcery from Russell Wilson. He puts out these workout tapes. We're like, man, he looks good. He looks like he trimmed down. He's throwing a good ball. And I'm like, I'm a 35-year-old, you know, albeit I was a 7-time intramural flag football champion at CU. So I'm no slouch, okay? Arguably the greatest intramural flag football quarterback of all time in CU history, not to toot my own horn. So it's not like I'm starting from zero, okay? And, yeah, that's supposed to sound ridiculous. But
it does.
He reels you in with these workout videos, and you think that they're a big deal. And all I wanted to do was illustrate that it's not that big of a deal. Like, he's not putting in that kind of work. And I heard from a lot of Steeler fans, Matt, that people were saying, oh, well, Mike Tomlin's not going to allow these kind of videos. You know, he's going to be more serious. It's like, well, how's that going for you? Because if you're honestly getting excited about that little reel that he put out, that little video, I made mine just to kind of temper your expectations and be like, see, not that big of a deal. Because a 35-year-old body worker who does not get paid hundreds of millions of dollars to play quarterback can do all that same shit.
So, what you're telling me is people actually got angry at you for making fun of them?
There were, like, the funniest one that I saw, dude, there was one lady, and she's... Anytime that someone in Broncos country tweets something negative about Russell Wilson, I'm convinced that this is either Sierra or it's somebody that's on his payroll that is just paid to scour Twitter and to respond to everyone that says anything negative about Russell Wilson, because we know his PR team is among the best in the NFL, right? And so she made Sierra a point to tell me that Russell Wilson is quicker than me and he's slimmer. And I'm like, quicker? Whoa, probably. Yeah. Slimmer. We're the same build.
I don't know, man. You got a nice little jawline right here. You're looking pretty good today, dude. I'm just saying, you've been on the fucking weights. If I, you know, shit.
You know what I'm saying? Like, this is what we got to do.
Well, yeah, you got a line in your fucking good for you, Mario. You jerk off now. Your right knee. So proud of you.
Ambidextrous, baby. Come on now.
Oh, fuck, you're a two-hand jerker. Cool, man. It's like skiing.
I do have to use the hands sometimes. Yeah.
I mean, look, you're a contributor on Let's Talk Broncos. You do your own podcast. How do you think this is going to go with Russ going to Pittsburgh with the Justin Fields thing? You know, his numbers weren't terrible, but we all watched the play. What do you think?
I mean, honestly, dude, I've been saying this. I think Pittsburgh was probably the perfect place for him to go, because if you look at the success that he had in Seattle, always had a really good defense, always had a really good run game, and they kind of called his number when they needed it. And for the most part, he made plays when he needed to. Now he goes to a Pittsburgh situation that's really very similar to what he had in Seattle. I don't think that they're going to rely on him that much. And he's going to a coach in Mike Tomlin, who's never finished under 500. He always makes the playoffs despite who his quarterback is. I mean, my God, they had Kenny Pickett, Mitchell Trubisky, and Mason Rudolph, and they made the playoffs. And so I think it's well within reason to assume that the Steelers again will make the playoffs. And I think they're also smart enough to not expect that much from Russ. They have two really good running backs. They have a couple of really good weapons, like, you know, a George Pickens. He's a perfect Russell Wilson wide receiver, because Russ just needs to throw the ball up to him. He's a 50-50 ball guy, and he's going to come down with it the majority of the time. And they have the great defense. Their defense is going to keep them in games. They're never going to lose by a lot. And so, I mean, in terms of situations, like, of all the other 31 teams, this is probably the best place that Russell Wilson could have gone to, because they've learned how to win without, like, with below average to shitty quarterback play. So that's the thing. Russell Wilson doesn't need to be that good this year. He just needs to be Russ. And the rest of the team, the way that it is structured, like, that, they just make the playoffs. They inexplicably win games. And so I guess you can credit a lot of that to Mike Tomlin. So, I mean, call me bitter if you want. I hope that they don't succeed. I hope that the Broncos boat race them out of Mile High when they make their inevitable comeback. I hope that, you know, Russ shows in that game what we saw over the last 2 years, where he just couldn't get over the hump and he had absolutely no pocket presence. And if you're one of these people that want to blame the offensive line entirely for Russell Wilson, then you clearly weren't watching the games and you don't understand any sort of advanced analytics, where a lot of the sacks he was taking was actually Russell's fault. But that's another conversation for another day. I don't want to see him succeed because he came to Denver for 2 years. I think they gave him something like $500 billion and he won us 11 games. I mean, say whatever you want about it, it wasn't enough. They traded the house for him. And they gave him all of this money because they thought not only he would get them back to the playoffs, but he would make them a legit contender, and he wasn't able to do it. Bottom line.
Now, look, you, in my opinion, you're the Jedi of the human body, all right? You do a great job. You work on me. You work on Bree. You work on a ton of the Broncos, a ton of Buffs. I mean, if you're in this town, you're definitely, and you're an athlete, you're working on them. I mean, when you look at Russ, he's never really had significant injury. And he hurt his fucking finger. How did he fall off this fast, bro? Like, I understand that age is undefeated. I get it. I understand how hard it is to stay at a fucking elite level forever. But he went from 40 touchdowns in the playoffs every year in Seattle and came here and looked like an absolute shell of himself. I mean, did he just fucking hammer fucking cookies and ice cream and just fucking sit in the house and look at himself in the mirror and just be like, man, I'm Mr. Unlimited. Like that. Did that just a full year of that shit just ruined Russell Wilson forever?
Yeah, I think he just became Mr. Limited. He was Mr. Limited. I mean, and I'm sure you saw this, Matt. He basically blamed the first year, like the struggles that he had, on a lat injury. And your approach to this is probably the same as mine, especially as a body worker. But if you make the decision as a professional athlete to play, you do not get to blame an injury on your failure. Because if it's that bad to the point where it's affecting your game, then you should not be playing. And he kind of addressed that, but not really. So the thing is, like, if you are playing, you are not going to be held to a lower standard because you're not 100%. If you're on the field, the expectations remain the same. It doesn't matter what the situation is. So we blame the lat. I mean, blame Hackett, blame the lat, blame whatever you want. It seemed like 2 seasons ago was a bit of an anomaly, right? Like, I think we can all admit that. I think part of the reason that he wanted out of Seattle is because he wanted to cook. Russ wanted to cook. And so when he came, fans, myself included, were really excited because it's like, oh, we're finally going to get Russ out of his box. You know, Pete Carroll was holding him back, when it turns out that Pete Carroll was actually protecting him from himself. So they tried to unleash Russ. They tried to let him cook, and he burned down the kitchen in his first year. Now, like you said, this past season statistically was a little bit better, but I think anybody who watched the games and who kind of understands film, he just wasn't good enough. Now, if he was getting paid somewhere, you know, in the top 15 of quarterbacks, then I don't think that there would have been a problem with his game. But the thing is, you're giving him this contract. You have certain expectations. And anybody that wants to say, oh, well, it's not his fault that he got the money. No, of course not. Okay. The Broncos signed him to this monster deal, but it is absolutely his fault that he did not play well enough to live up to that contract. And I'm so sick of people blaming the front office for giving him said contract when he's the one that didn't live up to it. Like, point are we going to displace blame and blame the person whose fault it is? He wasn't good enough. He didn't win enough games, period.
That's fair. He was not good enough. He didn't win enough games. That's true. Oh, but how can you defend the front office when they didn't need to extend him? They had 2 years on the he could have played the 2 years or at least a year before they extended him. It's like they birthday gifted him the fucking contract. That is directly on the front office. So I understand that Like, oh, 100%. He has to shoulder the blame. But GP and everybody, like, this was pre-Sean Payton that they gave him this extension. If they knew that Hackett was going to be gone, which everyone could read the writing on the wall, why in the Tiffany fuck would you ever give this guy a deal when you don't have to? Like, at least wait for a year and see if he can live up to the $250 million you're going to give him. I mean, that is like gross incompetence to me.
Yeah, you're 100% right, and I completely agree. I think at the time, you know, obviously now hindsight is 20/20, because the thing is, you know, what if in an alternate universe he balled out in that first year and then it actually cost him more money? So I'm sure at the time they thought it was going to be cost effective. There's no way they thought that he would be so bad that he would only last here 2 years, and they're paying him, what is it, $86 million to play somewhere else, whatever that is. But you're right. I mean, no, man, but it does fall on both, right? And call me hypercritical of Russ all you want. You're right. The contract, they should have waited. I don't know at the end of the day whose decision it was, because you hear different things. I don't know if it was George Payton. I don't know if it was the Walton Penner group who are like, you know, we got to get this extension done. And I mean, you're right. And I think never in a million years did they think he would only last 2 years and he would be so bad that he would be out of here after two seasons. So, yeah, it was a bad contract. But, I mean, I'm going to lay the majority of the blame on Russell Wilson, especially, man, hearkening back to what you were saying earlier. He came in his first year here. He was overweight. Like, guys in the locker room were making fun of the fact that he had a dad bod. He had love handles. Like, those are real conversations. And you're getting that kind of money. And this is why I put more of the fault on Russ. It's like, you get that kind of money, you're entrusted to save the franchise. And aside from these silly ass little videos that you're putting out, what work are you really putting in? And then he trimmed down this past season. He looked a little bit better. He looked more competent in the Sean Payton offense. But I think everybody saw the writing on the wall that, like, everyone knows Sean Payton didn't like Russell Wilson. Russell Wilson has made all of his money, made a living outside of structure. And Sean Payton is the exact opposite guy, where everything has to be in structure. And I think it was during Radio Row, or at some point, Drew Brees had come out and said, like, that offense that he watched was unrecognizable. And so all the people that are trying to say that Sean Payton didn't do enough to cater to Russell Wilson, first of all, Russell Wilson's getting way too much money to fully cater to him. But then the comments made by Hall of Fame Super Bowl winning quarterback Drew Brees lend itself to believe that Sean Payton did, in fact, try to cater to Russell Wilson. He had to put the training wheels back on, and it worked okay, but not well enough.
All right. So look, as they move on here, Justin Simmons, Patrick Surtain Jr., jerseys are right behind you. You work on both of them. How upset were you about about Simmons getting cut? Because I thought it was an awful move. And then if you're Patrick Surtain, why would you resign here? Why?
Yeah, I mean, the Justin Simmons move obviously made me sick. And I mean, I could talk about it until I'm blue in the face, but I'll just say, for a rebuild standpoint and for Justin's sake, like, I'm glad, because I think it's going to be a rough couple of years. Justin's never had the opportunity to play in a playoff game. And so hopefully, you know, all signs indicate that at some point he will sign with a contender somewhere he believes can possibly go to a Super Bowl, or at the very least go to the playoffs. Like, the dude just wants to win. He's been here since 2016, and they've never even really sniffed the playoffs, if we're being perfectly honest. Like, It was a shock if they were playing competitive football in December. Like, it got to the point where that was a feather in our cap, right? So that's the only good thing that I see for Justin from, like, a personal standpoint. But from a team standpoint, as far as I know, they didn't even ask him to restructure. They didn't try and figure anything out. They released him. They said, you know, good luck. They wanted him to test the market, which, you know, they did right by him by not trading him, so that he can pick the team that he goes to, which is nice. And then in terms of Pat Surtain, I guess the only reason that he re-signs here is he believes in Sean Payton. He thinks that he could turn it around. And they give Pat Surtain more money than God. And I wouldn't be surprised if they tried to get an extension with Surtain done at some point this offseason as opposed to next year. Because the longer you wait, the more expensive it's going to be. You might as well let him reset the cornerback market right now and then let everybody else catch up later. So I guess those would be the two big things that would probably keep PS2 here, are he believes in what Sean Payton's doing and think that he can, you know, rebuild this thing, and he's going to make an exorbitant amount of money. I mean, and the fact that, you know, I work on him. And I know that's actually like a really, really big piece of the puzzle, and he understands that.
Yeah, he's so good.
That's probably reason number one. Yeah, if he goes somewhere else, he knows he's not going to have access to Vetanze therapy.
Exactly, and when you're rubbing his right ass cheek, it gets his left ass cheek going, and that ass is moving, and he's a first-team All-Pro. Now, look, I will say this.
Get in that ass. Get in that ass,
Mario. Get in that ass, Mario. I've been to see you at your place. I know exactly how you get there. You're gentle, but still very, 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 very rough at the same time. It's kind of weird. I kind of like it.
I miss your big mastodon ass, that's for sure.
Well, I'm coming in there soon. I'm coming in there soon. Look, you may call me a water buffalo, but what's the name of the little fucked up one off of Ice Age?
Sid.
You look like Sid, so it's
you're
okay.
I said you're a woolly mammoth. I think that that's
I'll
a compliment.
Yanny, you can be Sid. It'll like be fun.
Yeah, you're the mile high mastodon.
I'll take that, the mile high mastodon. That's actually pretty fucking good, man. I dig it. All right, so look, I personally think the Broncos are setting themselves up for a notoriously bad season. All right, I was part of a team that was 4-12. The next year, they fired the whole shebang and fucking drafted Von Miller. So sometimes you got to go through hell to get to heaven, right? I think that they're going to be really bad.
Yep.
And this takes us to our next question. All right, throw up that stuff about Shedeur, if you would, please, Bree. Shedeur Sanders, you know, Travis Hunter, they got some great – obviously, Shedeur is the quarterback that we're going to be talking about. Coach Prime came out and said that, you know, they're not going to play for certain teams in the NFL, and he's going to make sure that they go to the right places, his son specifically. So, if I'm fucking Denver right now, bro, I am absolutely sucking for Shedeur. Like, come on. Shedeur, you can have the opportunity to get Shedeur Sanders in orange and blue to be your future quarterback with everything that Coach Prime brings right up the street. And, you know, find a way to manipulate it and get him and Hunter, which probably won't happen. But, you know, if let me ask you this. Who would you rather have out of the two? And then say they get Shedeur, how excited would you be to get him in orange and blue?
I mean, at this point of where the Broncos are, as phenomenal as Travis Hunter is, and he is absolutely unbelievable. Yeah, he's going to have to pick a position. Like, I assume he'll be a full-time corner, and then maybe they'll have some packages on offense for him, you know, a la Champ Bailey, a la Deion Sanders kind of earlier in their career. I assume it, because you can't go full bore both ways, like not in the NFL, just that impossible. But Well, you know what? I guess we'll see. As a body worker, Matt, I would advise against
this. This is what I'm asking. Look, I played both ways, but I never played in a game both ways. I practiced both ways a lot. Like, I played a lot of defense and then moved to offense. So I guess I played both ways. But we're talking about a guy playing 50 snaps on offense and 65, 70 snaps on defense. Where would you rather have Hunter, bro? Would you rather have him as an all-time defensive player? Or would you rather have him as an all-time offensive player? Where do you think he can affect the game more?
I mean, I think based on his skill set, I would rather have him as a full-time corner, because then the thing is, he can still get offensive snaps. You know, you have some packages for him where he gets 5, 10, 15 plays on offense. You manufacture touches for him because he's so unbelievable. But I think the majority of his value is going to come from corner. Now, if you're asking me, like, for this Broncos team currently, who I'd rather have, it's obviously Shedeur Sanders, because you don't have a quarterback. Even if they draft a guy, I mean, unless they trade up, man, you know this, unless they land one of the big four that everybody are talking about, you're looking at a Bo Nix, a Michael Penix Jr., Michael Pratt, Spencer Rattler, you know, these tier two, tier three guys, they don't move the needle, right? Shedeur Sanders moves the needle. He's a franchise quarterback. And speaking of people arguing with me on Twitter, I'd actually put that out, Matt. Like, and I put it out a lot about how I would love Shedeur to be the Broncos quarterback next year. And you would be shocked at how many people think that he can't play. They don't want him here. They don't like his attitude. They don't like the circus that comes with being Deion.
We just had a guy on the comments say it's too much of a circus. Just draft Hunter. What? Look, right there from Warning, Comma Trigger. And we really appreciate
exactly
you
what I'm
being
talking
part
about
of the show, brother. I'm all about it. Like, but hey, but at the same time, you know, like that circus is welcomed, right? Like, why go draft a guy that you're not really sure about just to be average and then not have an opportunity next year to get an elite player. Like, the Broncos have put themselves in this situation where now they're talent depleted. No free agents want to sign here. They overpaid on a lot of players. They're in this situation because of the decisions they made. But it may put them in a very, you know, fortuitous situation here moving into next season if they just don't go out and try and win six games when they're a two-win team. At some point, you just have to fucking embrace the fact that you suck and, you know, and then go out and put yourself in a position to get Shedeur, Carson Beck, Dylan Gabriel, something like that. Like, you know, I do Coach JB's show all the time, and we were on there this morning arguing about this. He doesn't think Shedeur can play, which I think is fucking crazy. I guess
he's wrong.
My question to everybody out here, everybody in the comments, and Mike Bundy, we really appreciate the donation here, and thank you so much for watching. And anybody else that wants to contribute, please do. You have an opportunity to get a homegrown kid. You know, I know he's not from Colorado, but he wears black and gold, and he's going to go down. I don't know, dog. He has another great year next year, and they win games and go to the playoff potentially. Is Shedeur the best quarterback in Colorado history?
Easily. Whoa. I mean, he's already knocking on the door. I mean, Matt, you could make a case that he's already
you think he's a better player than Cordell?
In Colorado history. I think Cordell was before his time, right? I think if Cordell had come around a little bit later.
We're not talking about, like, is he better than Cody Hawkins and fucking Tyler Hansen, homie? Like, I'm talking, like, I understand that Hagan ran the option and they're different kind of players. But I'm looking at it like it's right now, is Shedeur a better player in Colorado lore than Cordell, than Darian Hagan, than Pesavino, than Joel Klatt, than Machete?
Not yet. Like,
is he there yet?
Not yet, but again, he's there. Like, he's got to have some sustained success. I think they have to go to a bowl game this year. I mean, Matt, you know as well as anybody, because I know you were outspoken about it. Like, the offensive line last year was an absolute joke. Like, it was a bigger tragedy than Macbeth. Okay, they can't go through that again. And so Deion went out and he made all the moves that he needed to bulk up that offensive line, because A, he doesn't want to get his son and his QB1 killed, and B, he knows if Shedeur has a little bit of time that he's going to pick defenses apart. Okay, they got the skill position players, they got all the, like, that's locked in. And the fact that they bulked up that offensive line, like, they're going to be better because they can't be worse. Like, last year's offensive line set the bar unbelievably low. And that's what I want to say to these people that think, yeah, like, anybody that thinks that Shedeur didn't have a good year, or he took too many sacks, or whatever you want to say, go watch the offensive line. I mean, Matt, I can't tell you how many times, even against Colorado State, who really had inferior talent compared to CU, they're living in the backfield. A lot of these games where Shedeur had a hard time kind of getting the offense going, it's because the pass rush is on him as soon as he's catching the snap. What on earth is he supposed to do? Like, he has all these great skill position players at his disposal, but he can't actually use them because he has no time to go through his reads and go through his progressions. So anybody saying that he struggles to go through progressions, you can't go through the progressions with a second and a half to throw the ball. It's impossible. Nobody can do that.
And so look, I think this
is going to be the linchpin year for Shedeur.
And look, obviously, you know, both of us covering the Broncos as long as we have, Mario, your feelings on old Patty Boy being the OC in Boulder have got to be, like, I'm super excited about next year. I am. But I'm praying to God that Pat Schumer, what, how do you say his last name? Shermer. Pat Shermer.
Who cares?
If he's the OC, which he is, do you think he's going to be able to put everybody in the best position possible, or are we going to be out practicing incompletions like he's been doing with the Broncos in the past? Like, that is the one thing that gives me pause. And I understand from, like, a national perspective, a lot of people won't understand why we're talking about this the way we are, but we watched him in Denver with, you know, with an NFL roster and NFL players. Absolutely. I mean, it was terrible. You can't say it wasn't. The development of the quarterback was terrible. The play calling was terrible. The time management was terrible. Like, I understand that he's a qualified coach and he's been a head coach. No one's trying to say he doesn't know what he's talking about. Do you think he's going to be able to do a great job with Shedeur? Or do you think he's just, you know, the writing's on the wall and he's an average offensive coordinator that could end up hurting or hurting Shedeur Sanders?
Yeah, I mean, that remains to be seen. And this is the same guy who had a player in Phillip Lindsay who had back-to-back 1,000-yard seasons and then told Phillip Lindsay that he had no role in his offense. You know, I know, Matt, I don't mean to upset you, but yes, that is exactly what happened. And I know your feelings on Jerry Jeudy, but this is also a guy who was not having Jerry Jeudy run routes past 10 yards. It's like a lot
of a whorehouse.
Let's not get bogged down into that. Okay. I'm just saying, like, a lot of what he did was very suspect. And he's one of these guys, he's one of these old head coaches that says, you have to fit my system. I'm not going to fit yours. And so I hope that at the college level, and especially like under someone like Deion Sanders, who, you know, Deion's main thing, aside from obviously winning football games, is he wants to showcase Shedeur. That's why it was such an odd decision to bring in a guy like Pat Shurmur, right? So hopefully that there's some sort of connection here where Shurmur knows that he has to highlight Shedeur, and not just to make him look good, not just to solidify him as the first overall pick in the draft, but because the offense goes through him. If you have an elite quarterback in college football, you will win a lot of games and you will be competitive. So the other thing that I'm kind of considering is one of the knocks on Shedeur is, like, you know, he plays out of structure a lot. He throws on the run. And we're seeing more and more that NFL teams want guys to be able to play in a, quote, pro-style offense. So maybe Deion Sanders had this forward thinking of, all right, we want to run a more pro-style offense. It might be a little bit more boring than some of the stuff that we were doing last year. It's not going to be one of these, you know, five wide spread offenses. It's not going to be, you know, a USC offense with Lincoln Riley, nothing like that. We're going to get him more in structure. We're going to get him in a pro style offense so that scouts can see that and say, oh, well, obviously Shedeur can play off schedule, but he can also play on schedule. He can also be a pocket passer if he needs. That was kind of like my knee jerk reaction to when they hired Shurmur. And you have to believe that Shurmur is growing as a play caller, because if he's not, and if we get the same crap that we got from Denver a couple, like, for those several years, it's going to be rough. It's going to be a long year and it's going to be boring.
And, you know, looking back on it, we had a great interview with Coach Prime here on 0-60 in the beginning of March, and go check that out. It's still up on YouTube. We're on Twitch now as well. You can go on Twitch and watch. Twitch will be rolling at 5 a.m. tomorrow at the gym. We appreciate all the subs and all the love. Anything you guys can give is greatly appreciated. Thank you very much. But looking back on that interview with Coach Prime and talking to him about when he knew that Shedeur was that guy, I think Shedeur understands that there's so much pressure and lights on him, but he absorbs it. He doesn't, like, it doesn't affect him in a negative way. I think that this kid has just been so, you know, molded by his superstar father that he absorbs this, and any hate is fuel and any praise is deflected. He's like, yeah, I already know I'm a bad motherfucker. So that, to me, being around so many great quarterbacks, you know, playing with Brett Favre and shit, like, just being around that, the difference between, like, my boy Chad Pennington and I love to death, but when Chad's our quarterback and then all of a sudden Brett Favre walks in, there's a difference. Like, there's a huge difference in just the feeling, right? So
Swagger.
I think Shedeur's got that. And I truly believe that if you took the logo and the name off and just watched the way that he operates and what he does and how he does things, I think his stock would go through the roof even more, because there's a huge contingent of people that hate him because his last name is Sanders, and there's a huge contingent of people that love him because his last name is Sanders. So when you've got football lineage and legacy like the Sanders family does, the Manning family, the Matthews, the Longs, you know, like, just looking around, just football dynasties and a house, Kelsey's, you know, the Sanders now are going down this road where you're going to have two sons in the NFL and the father being the GOAT. So I think that he feeds off of all of this in a very, very productive way. And then when you throw Travis Hunter in there, who I think is the best two-way player I've ever seen, like, and maybe one of the best just pure talents I've ever seen in my entire life. the importance for those two, especially, and Shiloh, obviously, because he's such a good player, but he won't go as high in the draft as the other two. Just we'll just throw him into there. How important is it for those three to understand that, yes, they are superstars, and yes, they're the point, the tip of the spear, and everything's about them, but if they figure out how to really lead the rest of their guys and everyone's equal, not the same, but we're all equal, CU could be really special, but we can't have it so, you know, the top five guys on the team are treated differently or they look at things differently than the other 90. You know what I'm saying? If they can figure out a way to motivate the other 90 guys to roll with them the way that they roll, bro, you're going to have a fucking monster in Boulders. How do you think they're going to be able to manage that?
Honestly, I think it all starts with Shedeur. I mean, it's important for Travis Hunter to be that guy. It's important for Shiloh Sanders to be that guy, but it begins and ends with Shedeur Sanders. And the thing that I like most about him, he has something that you cannot teach, and that's a clutch gene. A quarterback can have every single solitary tool that he could have to succeed. If he doesn't have that gene where the game is on the line, you have to go down and score. You got to get into field goal range. You got to get it into the end zone. And he feels absolutely no pressure. You either have that or you do not. And that is what sets Shedeur Sanders aside. And that's the biggest thing that when you watch film or you want to criticize him for this and for that, that's the thing that you can't measure. You either see it or you do not. And that is the most glaring thing that we see with Shedeur. The moment is never too big for him. And I think when other guys around him see that, and they feed off of that, and they know, like, they're never out of a game. If they have to go down and get a score, they know that he can do it and that he is going to do it. It's the Tom Brady effect, right? Like, he even said when they went down and they ended up beating Colorado State, they went down, they scored the touchdown to tie it, got the two-point conversion, you know, lit it up in overtime. He said he tapped into Tom Brady. And that is something that you cannot teach. And it's like, you know, Matt, as an athlete, as a former professional athlete, if you have a quarterback who is a leader and you have complete and utter faith in them, and you know in your heart of hearts that there is no moment that is too big for them and that they will always overcome said moment, everybody else feeds off of that and they rally around it. And that's the biggest reason that I have Shedeur Sanders as, you know, QB1 going into next year. That's the big reason why he's probably going to be the first overall pick, is because you cannot teach that. And he hasn't. Whether it's being Deion Sanders' son and it's just indoctrinated into him or whatever it is, he has something that very few other quarterbacks have. And it, as long as the guys feed off of that, like, here's the thing, Matt, they all know how it's going to work, right? Every player on that team knows about Shedeur Sanders. They know about Deion Sanders. They signed up for it. Is it a little bit of a circus? Yeah. But look how many eyes were on CU football last year. You cannot pay everyone for that kind of, you can't pay for that. When you got College Game Day going, you got The Rock showing up, you have all these musical artists that I've never heard of because I'm out of touch, but all the young kids know exactly who they are. The biggest thing that these kids want to accomplish by going to play college football, they want to have eyes on them from scouts so that they have a chance to play on Sundays. And last year, even though CU wasn't the best and they didn't have as good a season as we had all hoped, all of the eyeballs were there. That is how you attract more people to your program. That's how you continue to build your program, because these kids know that they're going to be held to a really high standard and that there's going to be plenty of film on them and plenty of eyes on them because of what's happening with Sanders. Now, you factor that into the fact that they have the stud quarterback. They have the best two-way athlete ever. Shiloh Sanders, again, he's a phenomenal leader. He does what he says he's going to do. He plays he lays the boomstick. You know exactly what you're going to get from him. He's going to bring the energy. And so with those three guys, the best thing about him, Matt, is they all kind of do something different. They all have kind of like their different role. You know, Travis Hunter isn't necessarily like the rah-rah emotional leader that like even Shiloh is. I would say Shiloh's probably like the biggest energy guy out of the three of them. But then we saw a lot last year when Travis Hunter was on the sideline. He is coaching up other guys, like he's telling them what to do. And so he's a leader in a different aspect. So you have these different tiers of leadership that trickle down to the rest of the team. And it seems like all three of them have now kind of settled into their roles or going into their second year for CU football. And all you can hope is that all these other players understand that, yeah, they're going to get the shine. Sorry, but not sorry, because that's how you're going to win football games. But now what are you going to do to get your own shine? And if you are emotionally intelligent and emotionally tough enough and mentally tough enough to handle said prime effect and the fact that these guys are going to get the shine, you know that you're also going to get your moment, and you got to be ready when it comes.
My man Mario Vetanze is joining us here. Vetanze Therapy, the Altitude Adjustment Podcast, writer, contributor for Let's Talk Broncos. He works on me and my body all the time. He works on Bree, works on a bunch of the Broncos. Last question before we get you out of here, bro. Really, thanks to everybody getting involved with the subs, the super chat and everything. Remember, you can go on Twitch and follow us as well. We're there also on TikTok. We'll be on live there. I get, every time I go on TikTok live, I get banned for like a week. The minute I start talking, I get banned. There's a lot of softies out there. But that's neither here nor there. Mario, moving forward here with the Buffs, the Broncos, you know, Colorado is all eyes seem to be on the great state of Colorado these days when it comes to sports. Like, just everything. We got multiple teams in the tournament, and the Nuggets are kicking ass. The Avs are at the top of their game. You know, the Buffs seem like they're turning it around. CSU, it looks like they're on the up. Even, you know, we'll see what happens with the Sheep on the football field. You know, neither here nor there. At what point do you think the Broncos are actually going to get back to where they should be? And is it determined pretty much on drafting the right guy, which is Shedeur Sanders, next year? Like, I do not want them to take a quarterback this year. I'd rather them trade out of 12, move back, accumulate tons of draft picks, fortify the lines. I don't think that there's a future for McGlinchey, Powers, and Bowles here. Like, they're going to have to figure – they already lost Lloyd. Are they going to – like, they're really not going to fucking pay Quinn Miners? Like, at what point is this going to be a true rebuild rather than just, like – bro, I'm so tired of them throwing shit against the wall and seeing if it's going to stick. Like, just suck, accumulate draft picks, get rid of everybody that was part of this, like, 8-9 year window of just super average, very underachieving football, and build around a guy in Shedeur Sanders that can elevate you through the fucking roof, bro. How do you feel about that?
Yeah, I mean, it's honestly, it's great that they're finally committing to a rebuild, because, I mean, you cycle through guys like Case Keenum and Joe Flacco and Teddy Bridgewater. You bring in guys with really not a lot of tread left on the tires, or guys that are no longer elite, despite what Elway told us about Flacco. At the end of the day, they're not Super Bowl contending quarterbacks, at least, you know, not at the stage that we got them at, right? And so there were cracks in the dam, and each year those cracks got bigger, and they just kept trying to throw duct tape over it. They put band-aids over it. They would kind of plug and play instead of, like, truly rebuilding. And I think it's because, like, as a franchise, the Broncos have never been down this bad for this extended period of time, and they're not ever used to it. So the fact that they're finally committing to a rebuild, it's been a long time coming, and at least they're actually doing it. And it's funny because, you know, I keep saying myself, it's probably going to be a rough year. Like, we're probably not going to be very good this year. But then you look back at every year since the Super Bowl, and it's like, we really haven't been that good since the Super Bowl anyway. It's like, they've had a handful of good games. And, like, when they were playing meaningful football in December, like, we thought that was the greatest thing in the world. But those should not be the expectations for this franchise, which was once so proud and so wonderful, and you know, would go never having sub 500 seasons, certainly in back-to-back years. So you know as well as I do that the linchpin to a rebuild is you have to find your quarterback. And I'm with you. Like, at 12, they're not going to get one of the big four that, you know, everyone is talking about. And I don't love the idea of moving up, just because you have to solidify the rest of this roster. And the way that you rebuild is you find all of your weaknesses, you draft really well, and you hit on guys that you need to hit on. You don't take a quarterback just to take him. You know, if Bo Nix ends up being Sean Payton's guy, and Sean Payton is convinced that Bo Nix is the guy, great. I don't really see it. I think that he has a relatively high floor, but not a super high ceiling. He kind of just strikes me as just a guy. Michael Penix, it doesn't strike me as a Sean Payton guy whatsoever, because, you know, he doesn't really like to throw over the middle. And we just saw how that happened, you know, how that goes for quarterbacks last season with Russell Wilson. So I'm with you. Like, embrace the suck this year. Understand that, you know, you're probably not going to be a very good football team, and try and position yourself to draft a guy like Shedeur Sanders, like a guy at the top of next year's draft. Because if you're trading up this year, you're giving up too much. You're not going to be able to solidify the rest of your roster. And we saw it with Houston last year. Houston had a fantastic team this past year, but what was the linchpin? They had a really, really, really good rookie quarterback. And if you can hit on the quarterback, that is how you turn around and that is how you succeed in a rebuild. And for every story like that, there are a million cautionary tales of, you know, look at the history of Chicago, the history of Cleveland, the history of, you know, insert team here, where they just keep trying and trying and trying and trying to hit on quarterback and nothing ever seems to stick. So as Bronco fans, we have to have faith that Sean Payton can find his guy, whether it's this year or next year, and that the GMs and the front office can build up the rest of the team. Because on the adverse of it is, if you have a really good quarterback, but the rest of your team is no good, then that quarterback is never really going to succeed. And he's going to try and carry teams, and then eventually he'll end up there and he'll have success there.
Apparently, this is like herding cats. I mean, I don't know why I got to be a cat, but you're a sloth, so mammoth.
I don't know why sloth. You would hurt cats. I mean,
yeah, I don't know how you hurt a cat either.
But cats aren't as good as dogs, but I would never hurt one.
Mike Bundy said it's not easy to produce live shows. And I said it's like herding cats because he gave me a nice little shout out. I was just chatting with the people in the chat. Mind your own business.
Boss Bree, what, motherfucker, what? All right, so Mario, my man, so thankful for the last hour
you've been
from this morning to come on the show. Tell everybody about what you do one more time, how to get a hold of you. Look, as an ex-player who's beat up, I highly, highly, highly encourage everybody and advise you to go see this man. He does a great job keeping me upright, keeping me moving. He works on Bree and you know, her issues and through her hips and knees, and he works on so many players, and they all rave about him. So, Mario, tell everybody about what you do and how they can get a hold of you before we wrap this up.
Yeah, brother, I appreciate that. If you have any questions, you can certainly find me on Twitter. You know, hit me in the DMs at Vetanze Therapy. You can check out my website, VetanzeTherapy.com. I do manual therapy. You know, I'm a body worker, trigger point therapy, myofascial release, cupping, grassening, body balancing, athletic stretching, like you name it. If you need it, I got you. I'm a professional healer. It's what I do. I love what I do. And I certainly love getting to work on Matt's big ass, because, you know, everything has become so mundane. Like, I consider myself to be really good at what I do. And I also believe that if I didn't think that, then I wouldn't be very good at what I do. But I love working on Matt because he always presents a unique challenge, and he's a big crybaby, but we love him for it.
Okay. Hey, man, I know why my body hurts. That's for damn sure. All right. The softest touch in the business and the loudest voice that you can imagine. My man Mario on the show. Thank you so much. Have a great day, and we will definitely do this again. We will see you soon. Everybody go check out Mario and all that he does, and enjoy your day, Jedi.
Appreciate you, man. You're the best.
Peace. Later.
Bye.
All right, so great having Mario on the show this morning. I wanted to answer one of these questions here that I saw earlier before we get off here from Warning, comma, trigger. Don't you think something went wrong with the O-line last year in Boulder rather than just simply being bad? Yeah. I mean, I think that there were a lot of scheme issues that didn't allow them to even try and be average. I don't think that the players necessarily were the problem. Did they need to improve some places? Yeah. But, you know, is getting Jordan Seaton and the rest of these guys in, is it an upgrade? Substantially. But when you've got talent that maybe doesn't fit your skills in the trench, just like they had talent on the defensive side, you know, behind the defensive line, they didn't really have a lot of, you know, depth or intense interior defensive line play. You've got to work around that rather than just trying to be in a position where it's the thing that you can't overcome. So I like the fact that they improved as the season went on, but they restocked. They went out and find new guys. They went out. Coach Loadholt's the new offensive line coach. They got a new scheme. You know, Loadholt comes from the Coach Beatenbaugh school over at Oklahoma, and good. Coach Beatenbaugh is one of the best offensive line coaches I've ever talked to or been around. A good friend of mine and Six Zeros. Josh Bates is out there, one of our guys. All they do is put out motherfucking pros like crazy in Boomer Sooner land. So I feel like Coach Lodeholt will have a good scheme and a good way to coach them. I can't wait to get up there. I think this upcoming weekend, we're going to try and take a big group of all the elite guys from 6-0 Football Academy up there to visit before we hit the road to Kansas State, Oklahoma, and Nebraska. But Colorado, you got to have an identity. And like last year when they're, you know, 4 or 5 wide and that's 10 personnel essentially, or 11 personnel, 3x2, and you know, or they're 11 and they're, you know, they're spread and they're still running like zone read. The play action looks in the back, but you can't run the football. Like there's a lot of things that feels like there was a disconnect. And, you know, last year when I put out a video for the UCLA game, when they were really struggling with what's called a radar look where everybody's up moving around, you know, Coach Prime reached out to me after the game and was like, we're going to get this fixed. You know, obviously you care, you're right, we got to get all this fixed, yada yada. People persecuted me for it, but the head coach is reaching out to me saying that we got to get it fixed, and I'm right. So I'm going to listen to him more than I listen to the fans. For everybody that thought we don't like each other, it's sure weird that we did an hour-long interview and we're hugging it up and talking about hip-hop and shit, but it sure seems like guys don't like each other to me. I think that there's the opportunity for improvement is really all you want as a player. Like the opportunity to bring in a great coach like Phil Lodeholt, give him his first offensive line gig, a guy who played a ton of football and was around greatness, and see if he can absolutely motivate these guys and get them moving in a direction that's conducive towards, you know, running the football, just average. If they run the football in an average clip, they go from like 2 yards a carry to 4 yards a carry, and they can give you 20, 25 carries a game. Do you understand how much it's going to open up Shedeur, the passing lanes? It's going to slow down the pass rush. It's going to open up all the screen games. There's a reason it works so well against TCU and Nebraska, and then it didn't really work that well against CSU, is because TCU and Nebraska didn't have a book. They didn't know what we were going to run. They had no idea what to expect, and CU caught them off guard and also, you know, outplayed them. But CSU played us toe-to-toe when we had more talent because they had, you know, 2 weeks off. Remember, they played Washington State and had a bye before they came to Boulder. They had 2 weeks to just sit around and watch, evaluate, and get a book on Colorado and what they were doing. So I think that it you know, with a year under their belt, new players in the room, new offensive line and scheme, and then the ability to build around Hunter and Horn and Dylan Edwards and all the new cats they brought in, everything I'm seeing up in Boulder and how competitive it is, and you know, not necessarily everybody's out here getting along with each other. It doesn't seem like everybody's friends. This is football, not friend ball. So I really like that. I'm not trying to be in a room where we're all just fucking getting along. Like at some point, there's got to be a little bit of adversity and a little bit of like standard setting in order for everybody to get to where they want to go. The best way to go to the NFL and get the bag is to win in college. Then usually they don't like taking players that can't elevate their football team to W's. So, I mean, we'll see how all that goes. You know, right here, excuse me, transfer portal has damn near killed culture creation. Now, look, Patrick George, appreciate you on the show and contributing, brother. Thank you very much. I agree. It has killed culture. But at the same time, as a coach, you know, a lot of the time now the coaches or the kids are going to be committing to the coach, not the school. When I was coming out, I wanted to play at Colorado regardless of who the coach was. I committed to Coach Neuheisel. He went to Washington and thought that I would follow him there, and I laughed at him like, oh, you could give me $15 million. I'm not going to Seattle. I'm staying in Boulder. So back in the day, the school was the draw. Now I think it's the coach. You know, like Coach Saban leaves Alabama, Max Exodus. They don't want to stay at Alabama. You know, like Coach Prime comes to Boulder. He attracts so many eyes and so many dudes that want to come play for Coach Prime in Boulder rather than coming to Boulder to play for Coach Prime, if that makes sense. So I really truly believe that last year was necessary. The fast start was awesome, you know, starting 3-0 and beating your rivals. And then they had humble pie. They lost a lot of games by one score. And those games are all winnable, and they hurt so bad. I'd rather get my ass beat than lose by one score. But then again, when you lose by a score, it gives you so much, you know, so much positive thought and something to build on. That foundation is strong moving forward if you can fix the problem. So, you know, it, sometimes it's necessary to lose if you're learning. If you're losing and you're just a loser, that's not good. But if you're losing and learning, then you probably won't lose for that long. And then, you know, culture comes from the players, but it also comes from the coaches. You know, there's a lot of folks that are still talking about the fight song and so much, you know, things like that. You know, singing the fight song is like saying the cadence. It's basic training and helps build culture. I agree 100%. I think that they should sing the fight song. But again, I'm not going to die on this hill anymore because it's obviously not as important as I thought it was. So, you know, if they want to use that as a way to rally the troops together, the same way that you would say, you know, or the mantra up there, that the pride and tradition of the Colorado Buffaloes will not be entrusted to the timid or the weak. If everybody can't reiterate that, then why is it on the wall? So, look, there's a lot of things that Colorado has been done great and they can build off of. There's a lot of things that Colorado needs to improve off of or improve on and build off of moving forward. But I'll tell you, they got the personnel, they got the coaching staff, and it seems like they're on the right path moving forward. So great show today. We really appreciate any and all the interactions. 71 people watching right now. That's a big number for us this morning. We appreciate everything that has been going on in the comments and all the subs and all the, what is it called? The
super chats.
The super chats. So we really appreciate that. All the super chats. Got another one. Really appreciate that. That kicks ass. Patrick George, thanks for coming on and being part of it. Obviously, warning, comma, trigger. I do believe this is true. Believe. That's me. I'm the optimistic. I'm the fucking optimistic
you are also
one.
Optimistic.
I'm the opportunistic
optimist.
Boom, bitch. I got the gift of gab, baby. So, you know, I could sell a ketchup popsicle to a woman in white gloves, sand to a camel. I could talk the panties off of a nun. Motherfucker, what? Monday's rolling. I'm Matt McChesney. That's Bree Masons. Big fucking shout out to Mario Vetanze for coming on the show. Go check out everything he does. Tomorrow, my man JT O'Sullivan, who was the quarterback for the Frankfurt Digital Butthole / Galaxy when we were there back in the day. 10-11 year pro at the quarterback position, and also does a great job with his own podcast and breaking down quarterbacks with everything he does. He will be our guest tomorrow to talk about Shedeur and the state of NFL play with the quarterbacks and college players moving forward, and if the Broncos can suck enough for Shedeur. So everybody, let's get this fucking concept going. Suck for Shedeur. Suck for Shedeur. Suck for Shedeur. Let's go like 1-15. Suck it up. Terrible. Awful. So, like, even Bree doesn't want to go to the games. She's got fucking season tickets, and she doesn't want to go. That's how bad we need to suck. If that can happen, maybe it opens the door to get a generational talent in at the quarterback position and roll. But I'm telling you, if you think Jared Stidham is going to be the guy that takes us to the fucking promised land, then I want to know what your promised land looks like. Probably not very promising. So, I'm Matt McChesney. That's Bree. Mario's somewhere. And great show. So, enjoy it. Have a great Monday. We will be back tomorrow at 10 a.m. with JT O'Sullivan to talk about quarterbacks, so on and so forth. Follow everybody all over social media. Follow us on Twitch at 60 Academy, and it'll be up on Spotify and Apple Podcasts and everything as the day goes on. Thank you so much to Bet Online for all they do supporting the show. When you get back on the betting trail on Thursday and Friday for the tournament, hopefully you made some money last week. I know the big guy did, had a good weekend. You know, when you go in there, bet responsibly. Don't do anything stupid, and keep it rolling with our good friends at Bet Online. So have yourself a great day, and I will see you guys tomorrow. Go Buffs, go Broncos, and thank you, Bree.
Thank you.